Amazon Elastic File System, EFS, provides a simple, scalable, and fully managed shared file system for use with AWS cloud services and on-premises resources. Whether you're developing a new containerized application or modernizing an existing monolith, there are many types of applications where a shared persistence layer is an essential ingredient in achieving a resilient and durable architecture. These include stateful, long-running applications like content management systems, whose files change frequently as editors publish new content or administrators install plugins, and applications that need to share data with one another, possibly spanning multiple availability zones, such as machine learning frameworks or collaborative data science workspaces. Amazon EFS is the natural choice for these types of use cases. As a fully managed service, it's simple to set up, and it will scale to petabytes of capacity and several gigabytes per second of aggregate throughput automatically as you add and remove data. And if your workload requires higher throughput than that, you can achieve even more by using provisioned throughput. When you use Amazon EFS in conjunction with your containerized applications on AWS, you can feel confident that your shared storage solution is as elastic as the container infrastructure that depends on it. Let's take a look at an example scenario of one of these use cases. We have an Amazon Elastic Container Service, or ECS, cluster running a mix of tasks using both ECS on EC2 and AWS Fargate. The containers are all running a web application called Cloud Commander. We'll use it as a hypothetical production application for today. An application such as this might need varying degrees of read and write access to shared storage, and the familiar interface of a file manager will allow us to visualize these ideas more easily. The ECS on EC2 version of this application is running behind an Amazon application load balancer, and the Fargate version is running behind another. If we open up the first load balancer URL, we'll see an empty directory where we can drag and drop a file to upload it, and then double-click on it to view it. Notice, though, that if another user, represented by this other browser window, loads the same application, the file we just uploaded isn't there anymore. The other version of the application running on Fargate has the same behavior, and neither application can see what has been uploaded to the other. What's happening here is that the files we're uploading aren't being saved to a common location. They're being saved locally to whichever container happens to process the upload request, so there's no guarantee that different users would see the same files. That's definitely not what we want here, so let's fix it. In this demo, we're going to use Amazon EFS to create a shared file system, and then attach it to our existing Amazon ECS and AWS Fargate services. This will enable our example file manager application to interact with the same files no matter which container handles our requests. Once we've got EFS hooked up to both versions of our application, we'll then explore how AWS IAM authorization and EFS access points can simplify configuring more granular access to our data for different scenarios. If you'd like to try this out on your own later, you can use the AWS Cloud Development Kit, or CDK, to deploy the initial state of this demo environment to your own AWS account. A link to the sample code repository for that is available in the video description below. But for now, let's head over to the AWS console, open the Amazon EFS dashboard, and create our file system. Creating a basic EFS file system is easy. First, we choose the VPC the file system will be created in and its mount targets. In order for all of our containers to be able to access it, we must create a mount target in each availability zone. As a general best practice, we'll choose the private subnet for each availability zone for our mount targets. We'll also need to select a security group. The default security group is pre-selected for us, but we're going to choose this EFS demo FS security group that was created by the AWS CDK sample code so that we can limit access to the file system to just our containers. Next, we're shown several different file system settings that we can configure. We'll leave most of them alone for this demo, but let's give the file system a name and enable encryption of data at rest using the default AWS Key Management Service key for Amazon EFS before moving on. We'll come back to the additional client access settings later on in this demo. For now, let's continue and then click Create File System. Our EFS file system was successfully created. Now let's go make it available in the Cloud Commander application running in our cluster. To do that, we open the Task Definitions link in the Amazon ECS menu, select one of the task definitions, and click Create New Revision. First, we'll scroll all the way down to the bottom and click on the name of the existing volume to modify it. Instead of bind mount, we'll choose EFS as the volume type and then select the file system ID for the EFS file system that we just created. We'll get into access points later, so let's leave that alone for now. The root directory value tells us which directory in the EFS file system will be mounted as the root directory inside the ECS host. Leaving it as just /will mount the entire EFS volume's contents. We'll enable encryption in transit, and finally, we'll leave EFS IAM authorization disabled for the time being and come back to it later. Since we already had the bind mount volume set up earlier that we changed to an EFS volume, we don't need to make any changes to the container definition. For reference, if we were adding a completely new volume, we'd now need to go up to the list of container definitions, click Cloud CMD, and add a new mount point under the storage and logging section. That's not the case here, though, so we'll cancel out of that, scroll down to the bottom, and click Create to create the new task definition revision. We can start deploying this by choosing the Update Service option within the Actions drop-down menu. Please note that at the time of this recording, it's necessary to select 1.4.0 as the platform version. We can otherwise leave the rest of the inputs alone as we click through each of the screens, and then keep an eye on the deployment status until ECS has finished starting our updated tasks and stopping the old ones. This process is identical for both ECS on EC2 services as well as for Fargate services, so we won't walk through it step by step in this video. Same as with the previous walkthrough, we just need to wait until ECS has finished deploying our updated tasks and cleaning out the old ones, and then we're ready to try everything out. Now that the cluster is showing only the updated tasks running, let's open up both of our browser windows from earlier and see what happens. The first thing we notice is that the test files we uploaded at the start of the demo are gone. This is expected since the file was previously being saved on a data volume that was no longer available once the container was shut down, which is one of the things our new EFS file system is going to help us avoid. Let's try uploading a few new files. Okay, we can upload files and view them when we double-click. After refreshing the listing a few times and pretending to be a different user using a different browser, we can see that our files are still there. Now let's check and see what happens if we refresh the window using the other application running on AWS Fargate. Great, our files are still there too. By simply creating an EFS file system and mounting it to use as a volume in our containers, we have persistent, shared storage accessible by both of our example Cloud Commander applications running in multiple containers, and we know that our data will still be there even if we terminate these containers and launch new ones. But this is a pretty basic use case. In a real application, we're going to have several different services that don't all need the same level of access to the same file system. The traditional approach of relying on POSIX file system permissions can make this very difficult to configure, and may even require creating multiple EFS file systems to ensure that everything is locked down correctly. Instead, we're going to take a moment to dream up a very complicated scenario and then see how easy it can be to set up if we incorporate IAM authorization and EFS access points into our solution. So, what's our scenario going to be? Well, a service is going to have one of three types of access to a file system: read-only, read-write, or none at all. We have two services in our demo, so let's have our complicated scenario involve all of these combinations. We're going to set things up as follows. 1. Each service will have its own private storage shared with containers of its same type that only it can read and write. 2. Each service will have a location that it can write to that the other service can read from, but not write to. And 3. Both services will have access to a common location that they can both read to and write from like they have now. Okay, let's go back to EFS and configure this. We'll create the access points first. An access point can be thought of as an application-specific entry point into a certain location in an EFS file system. This lets us manage things like data access and user identities more easily. We're going to create some access points for each of the three scenarios mentioned earlier. First, let's configure the private access points for each of our services that only they are able to read from and write to. Let's start with Fargate. We'll call the access point Fargate Private and have its root directory begin at /private/Fargate. We also have the ability to specify a POSIX user and owner. The values entered under POSIX user will tell the mounted file system who we are, and the values under owner will define the ownership and permissions for the directory we specified when it gets created the first time we connect. To keep things easy to remember, let's use 7000 as the owner ID and group ID for anything related to our Fargate tasks, since the word Fargate has 7 letters. As for permissions, we only want our Fargate tasks to be able to read from and write to here, so let's set the permissions to 750. The configuration for ECS private is the same, except we'll input ECS instead of Fargate, and we'll use 3000 for the IDs since ECS has 3 letters. Next, we'll add access points for each service that they can write to and that the other can read from. And finally, we'll add a common location where both services can read and write freely, and then click Save Access Points to create them. It'll take a few moments after saving for them to become available, at which point we can define how access is going to work. Let's scroll back up and set our file system policy. There's no policy in place right now, so our file system is using the default policy of allowing any clients with network access to connect, which is why we were able to hook up the file system to our container so easily before. To get our policy started, let's check off these three settings to configure new defaults: disable root access, enforce read-only access, and enforce in-transit encryption. After clicking Set Policy, we can see the JSON tab has been populated with the familiar IAM-style policy configuration. Now we need to configure the policy for our own scenarios. We'll do one together step by step, and then fast forward through the rest. If you'd like to review any individual policy statement more closely, a copy of the entire policy is available at the same repository linked in the video description. Let's configure Fargate private. We want to allow our Fargate service, or more specifically, the task IAM role that it's using, to be able to mount and write to the Fargate private access point that we defined below. We can get that task IAM role's ARN from the Fargate task definition. It needs to be able to mount and write to the file system, and we'll specify that this policy statement applies to that Fargate private access point. Since it needs this same level of access for the Fargate shared scenario, we'll go ahead and add that access point here as well. The final policy looks like this, and we can use the SID values to help us tell at a glance what each section is for. Let's save this policy and go back to our task definitions to make the access points available. We'll quickly run through how to create the new task definition revision for the Fargate application. First, let's add the volume for the common access point, making sure to also check the Enable IAM Authorization box so that the file system policy we created earlier gets evaluated. Next, we'll do the private access point for Fargate. And finally, we'll do both of the shared scenarios: Fargate and ECS on EC2. We don't need our files example volume anymore, so we'll remove that before going to the container definition to add all of these new mount points. Note that since our sample application container uses the /files directory as its root, we need to be sure to mount our access points within that /files path in order for them to be accessible. There's the mount point configuration for common, both shared volumes, and the private volume just for the instance of our application that's running on Fargate. The process to do this for the ECS on EC2 application's task definition is identical, aside from the names, so we won't go through that step by step in this video. After creating both of the new task definitions and updating the services though, we can open up our two browsers again and see that they each have three directories: common, private, and shared. They can both read and write from each other's files under the common directory, read but not write each other's files under the matching shared directories, and they each have a private space for storing files under the private directory that the other can't interact with at all. Support for Amazon EFS on both AWS Fargate and Amazon ECS for EC2 is available in all AWS regions. To learn more about using Amazon EFS with your containerized applications, including documentation, blog posts, and the sample code from this demo, please visit the links in the video description below. Thanks for watching!